This will not be a lecture about our design projects. It will be more a lecture or a speak about how we work and the methods and the way we proceed and collaborate both internally in the office and with other clients. And I think a lot of the discussions and ideas about architecture today is a lot about, you know, the name and the brand and not so much about the process. And we as architects are really interested in the process, not just the result. So we have, Snøhetta actually have their 25th anniversary this year. We have two offices, one in Oslo and one in New York, Lower Manhattan. And we are totally around about 150 architects, landscape architects, designer, graphic designers, administration, chefs, and so on. This is our Oslo office. It has a great location by the sea. It's an old warehouse for the harbor authority, and we were very grateful to be able to get the space 10 years ago. This is our door, and we really like to be in one big space all together. And we don't specialize in different departments. We don't specialize in different teams. We try to mix together in one open space. And we all sit together clustered, not project-wise. We try to intentionally bump into each other so that we get the information and the understanding of the project that we do. So every second year, we shift places, so you get a new understanding and a restart of the office again. And the size of the office is about 55 by 30 meters, so it's a good space, and a lot of our project spaces relate to that space, in a way. So this is our New York office. It's on 25 Broadway. It's actually above the old ticketing hall for the Kooner ship that was the big boats going to America from Europe. So there's kind of this historic link there as well. Snøhetta emphasized on an open exchange between roles and disciplines. So we try to mix both the knowledge from the architect, the landscape architects, the interiors, and the graphic designer together. We've always been a multidisciplinary studio, and we try to collaborate with a lot of other architects, artists, and try to kind of get multiple voices within our designs. So we don't do the same design over and over, but we try to make a unique set every time. And our working conditions is really based on a good sense of humor, and we think that, you know, as an architect you work a lot and you have long hours, so having fun at the same time is very healthy, and it makes it much easier. And Snøhetta made a breakthrough in 1989 when they won the competition for the Alexandra Library. There were four young architects just fresh out of school that made the entry, and they were picked up, and nobody had heard about the office at that time. So after a long struggle negotiating, they managed to get the contract, and the building phase was going on up until, I think, finishing opening around 2003. So it was a long period, but it was a great project for the office. We moved the office to Cairo for a few years during the planning, and it has really become a gateway into our other projects in the region. And on this project, we worked a lot with artists and also with a way that you could kind of make a space that is in a library, but it's also just one big space underneath this roof. So all the people entering as guests will just be in the same. It's basically just a one room, and then some other sub-functionals that support it. And here you can see the stone wall in the back with all the signs from different languages from all over the world. And actually it was a Norwegian sculpture that was part of going there training the local workers to do the carving. And you know, it takes a long time to build things and buildings, and especially now, you know, they have had a very, very good director for the library, which kind of broadened the horizon for the library, so it's much more a cultural space than just a library. And during the riots in Egypt, they were trying to vandalize important cultural buildings because of the tension. And what happened was that the people of Alexandria kind of created a handheld chain around it so they could protect it for not being vandalized. And another major commission, which was for us in the Norwegian Opera House, we won the competition in 2000. And it was the first opera ever built in Norway. Previously, they were actually in an old theater, very, very lousy conditions. And I think for us, we have been working with this concept of this sloping roof for a long time, and kind of trying to make a public space that connects both to the sea and the sky and the mountain in the background. And it was quite a simple concept, but still it created a landscape, kind of a public landscape that has had a reference to a more, you know, other types of landscapes. And in Oslo at that time, it was a big discussion about that you should not use that amount of money on a cultural building. So by making this also a hybrid building, so it was more than an opera, it was also a public space that everybody could access to and could connect to the sea, I think was one of the more interesting part and made it a very, very welcome scheme when it was finally built. And we also try when we do this thing to make quite simple but still complex concepts, and also try to emphasize some rules in the design. So for instance, here we made a kind of an internal rule that that we try to use the same material. So where it's stone, it's only stone. Where it's glass, it's only glass. And where it's wood, it's kind of a lot of wood in that curved wall behind the foyer. And further up in 2004, we won a competition for the Memorial Museum at the World Trade Center in New York, which was the start of the New York office. And it was a very humble little building. And as you see on this site, it is the only structure that actually is built on the original World Trade boundary. And it was a long, long struggle because there was a lot of politics and a lot of tension and a lot of emotion involved. But we stayed with this commission for a long time, and it changed a lot during the days. And now it has become kind of an entrance building to the Memorial Museum below. And it's, as you see, probably know for the master plan that was made, it's only high-rise building around it. So you have this tiny little building in the middle that everybody's looking over. And I think we tried to make it a place where you could have a human scale and connect to the building and not just and get a little away from the scale of the surroundings. And there was a soft opening ceremony last year, and I think it will be finished and opening next year, the full scheme. And we're also doing other public spaces. This is a proposal we've been doing for the Times Square in New York, trying to get one of the busiest squares in New York to be more coherent and be a more public space where you could connect all the important streets around it. And it's been also a challenging project to develop at the same time as the planning, and it should be fully open for the public at the same time as construction. And we was also invited to do a competition for the San Francisco MoMA new extension. And it was the existing museum there is designed by Maria Botta, as you might know. So it was a postmodern brick building, and we were supposed to make an extension to that, which was very difficult because it was quite a challenging task. But we kind of ended up with this little bit yin-yang concept that the Botta is kind of the dark, heavy part, and we have tried to make a light extension that could relate to the sky and the shifting surrounding. So it's kind of tied back in back of the Botta building and open up to the small connecting streets and alleys in behind. And actually today they are making the topping ceremony for the steelwork. And the building will have a great art collection and some of the major works from Calder and Serra. So I think when it opens, it would kind of refresh the whole museum and make it more public and more open and transparent towards the surroundings. Snøhetta has been trying to work with a way of establishing a method to how we deal with creative processes. And we were part of a research program called Idea Work, where we were looking into different type of businesses, how they work with things creatively. And this turned out to be a PhD work and some other also publication related to that. And for us, we were at one point study objects for how we work, and later we kind of, based out of that, tried to identify a more informal way of starting a creative process. So we basically tried to identify some of the elements without creating a specified method with a specified result. So we tried to identify some of the things that you do and how you try to involve and get to know a client. And so one thing was that we tried to, a phase we call prepping, where you kind of look into, you prepare yourself for the work, and the second part is then zooming out and trying to look at the bigger picture. And then it was also important to get physical, to actually start doing, interact with the client and see if based on that you could dig out some interesting ideas. So I will show you a little animation of that type of work we've been doing. And this type of method could also work for architectural concept and also for graphic design and other types of work.
One of the interesting aspects of Snøhetta is that we have experienced our work in different parts of the world, different regions, different countries. And there's a wonderful and rich dialogue that can grow between these places. We work really as a sort of unified idea, but we find different experiences and different qualities that we're able to bridge or share between these locations. And that's part of what the experience of working with Snøhetta is, that you're experiencing a larger idea of human culture rather than a very specific or very narrow view of cultural ideas and ideologies.
Snøhetta Design is a multidisciplinary design group. Both graphic designers, interior architects, and landscape architects coming together and basically sitting down together with the client, getting their input and their information in an intensive day, creating a concept, an idea that's the core of their new image, their new brand. The workshops in and of themselves are a lot more casual than an average meeting. They're not a workshop where you sit in only a meeting room. We break out into smaller groups and we create things in the workshop. It's very hands-on, it's a little bit more relaxed. People are laughing and smiling, and they're using the tools that we have here in order to create these concept models in which we would present to the whole group after. I think in the beginning they might be a little surprised that we're getting out of the meeting room and coming into the workshop and getting a little bit dirty to start to cut wood or cut plastic and, you know, put assemble some materials together to create this object that might represent their new visual identity. I think it really sparks an interest in their own way of thinking about themselves or their company.
We're explorers here in many ways. Each day that when we come to work, it's an exploration. We're exploring different ideas, different attitudes, and we're coming to terms with the conditions of the things that we make. Good exploration requires teamwork, and it requires directness, and it requires good knowledge of the conditions that you're within. So in many ways, we deal with our projects, with our sort of endeavors, in a way that brings dialogue and promotes dialogue between different groups of people.
The workshops themselves allow you to throw out a lot of ideas in these groups where sometimes they, where the client might not know what is involved in coming up with the initial concepts or just the basic design process that as designers and architects we're sort of understanding that's our work is the design process. So it's fantastic to include them within that process and to show them the initial concept sketches and concept models without looking at a final product.
But having said that, I've done several of these projects in different constellations with different clients, and the good thing about it is that you get so much information that you never get from a brief or anything, because it becomes a dialogue and you understand more about what they actually want and what they not want. And based on these conversations, you can come up with maybe not the total concept, but a stepping stone, a starting point that we as an architect would never be able to do by ourselves. But Snøhetta is foremost a mountain, and it's one of the third largest mountain in Norway. And for us, we take an annual walk there every year, so walking is also a big part of our office. And I think for us it's been important to have an office that is not based on one person's name, but more of a team. So we always state that our projects with Snøhetta and not the individual person involved in each project. So here's us on our annual hike. We have now done it quite organized for the last 10 years. So I think 2 weeks ago we were like 90 architects and the whole office going up there. And it's a very good thing because it becomes this kind of place where you can have conversation and you can talk about things that you are not able to do in your everyday life at work. And it also this experience of walking this mountain, which is just a lot of rocks. And we have people from all over the world in our office, and not all of them are used to, you know, taking this hike into the wilderness. And we are also very interested between this way of traditional handcraft and the modern type of possibilities you can do with the technology today. And we try to find a way to bridge those into our office, because we find at one certain point that if you only work with the digital technology and the 3D models and the computer, you kind of put yourself far away from what is actually about the building and how you deal with it and the feel of things. So we kind of focused back on that and made a very good workshop within the office so we can always relate to that, but at the same time use the modern tools with 3D printing, with laser cutting, with now we also have a CNC mill, so we can do these things from the computer, but we always go into the kind of the hand work and back again. So we were approached by a very small organization in Norway called the Norwegian Reindeer Center. And they are an organization that protects and will spread knowledge about the wild reindeer. And they wanted a kind of a meeting place so they can have a class there and they can educate them. And we did a small design, which was basically a steel box with a wooden wooden structure core inside the steel box. So we made a steel frame, and this is the model, or you see the model which we milled in our office based on one wood structure, which would create kind of a landscape that you could sit in. And here you see our mill, and it was one of the first models we made with this. So it was great fun to try to do it. And we were at that point, we had been working a lot with boat builders on the west coast of Norway, which helped out with the balcony fronts of the opera house, which were then CNC milled from solid oak. And based on that collaboration, we took it further with them, and we made this piece, the wooden core that was carved out from our 3D model into pieces of core pine from Telemark in Norway, and brought to the site, which actually is a great site because it's it's overlooking the mountain of Snøhetta, so it has a very, very beautiful view. And it's become a very popular little building, and it's open in the summer and the autumn, so everybody can take a hike up there and sit there and watch the view. You see the mountains in behind, and when we do our annual walk, we gather the whole office there, and we have like a small pop-up lecture and things. And it's become this, you know, a point of interest for a lot of people that get off the rail train and take the small hike up to this little kind of open cabin. Here you see the site. And based on that, we also did a little bit more on graphic work and design for them to help them promote their little pavilion. And that's nice when you can tie the graphical work we do together with the architectural work. So that's been one of the additions to the office the last 5 years, is that we have had a design company and a brand design involved in our office as well. This is some of the work they've been doing. And also we've been trying to find links between architectural work and graphic design, and to trying to make the graphical design work more three-dimensional, so we could get some synergies between our different fields of work. This is a logo for Avinor, which is the flight company that has responsibility for all the airports in Norway, and they wanted a new identity, so we had this idea about connection. So it's the logo is about connecting points, and Norway is a very long country, so for many of small places the flight and the airport is a very important point of connection. And here you see some of their digital work and graphic design. And one of the major first jobs they got was actually the logo for the Norwegian bank. And they were able to actually try getting the client involved in this workshop, as you saw in the animation, that the client really got involved in how we work and the process, and that helped landing the design profile and the project with the Norwegian bank. And we have taken that further into other type of small pieces and three-dimensional elements, and we're also doing now interior works for them. So it's very interesting to see how graphic design and architecture and working with things can actually link together and influence each other. Here you see some of the interior spaces for the new bank. And we are also doing other type of cultural project. This is a visitor center for the Lascaux Caves in France. It's a national treasure in France. If you don't know, it's the caves were found in 1940s, and inside the caves there are paintings and rules that are over 17,000 years old. But due to humidity and the, you know, people were able to visit the caves up until, I think, early 60s. Then they had to close it because it was damaging for all the artwork in there. So they had to find other ways to try and make the people who are interested to come and see it. So what we were doing was making a very simple scheme on the site, just trying to get two or three cuts in and lifting the landscape and putting the small building inside of that. And actually what we are doing is to make a replica, actually two replica, of the original cave, which had been 3D scanned, and then they build a new cave based on that so people can have an experience of the cave itself without entering the original cave. So this is on building site now. I think it will open about in 1 year. Here you see some of the interiors that will be in the new visitor center. And you see it from entering point. And then we also do some interior works, and we have just recently, last week, opened a kind of a fashion concept store in Oslo on the main street. I'm not sure what it is, but it's what they wanted. And we also here try and to look into some of the previous work we've done with wood and so on, and see if we can explore new methods and ways to work with that. Here's some sketches of old building, so we just simply stripped down some of the spaces and added a few elements, a shelf, a kind of a signal wall towards the outside, and the staircase. So here you see some of this was from the opening last week. And the wooden wall, which was based on some of the knowledge we got from the milling of the core wall at the reindeer pavilion. And the next project is something that's been very important for us for the last 6 years. It's a project actually more about bridging and connecting and dialogue. We were invited to participate in a competition for a new cultural center in Saudi Arabia, which was, the client was Aramco, the Saudi Arabian oil company, which was going to give this building as a gift to their country. And we tried to find a way to make this something that has to do about bridging and about connecting. And the idea is actually from the Italo Calvino's book Invisible Cities, where you have the Roman arch, and the keystone in the Roman arch was the culture. So we tried to find a very simple concept that we could emphasize this, that the culture is really important in every society, and if you don't have it, it will collapse. So this was the scheme for the competition. It was based on a kind of a pebble-shaped structure clustered together to make this composition, and underneath will be a lot of cultural functions. And it doesn't really have a lot of windows or facades in that sense. It's more towards the inner quality of the functions. And still it will be this mirage in the desert, because this is in the eastern province of Saudi Arabia and towards Bahrain. And it's in the area where they first found the oil in Saudi. And you see it's also a huge park area, which we call the mono surface, which will have samples of plants and vegetation from all over Saudi. And here you see the full complex. The lower part is the existing facilities, and then you have the new cultural center in the upper part. For us, this was a big challenge, and also we had discussions within the office if this was something we're going to do because of the differences in culture and so on. But we ended up said that we really believed in the brief, that it could be, it would be host the first cinema in Saudi, one of the first performance spaces, a new museum and a gallery, and a learning center. So I think the attempt is trying to push the boundary from within. And, you know, in our days when the diversity between cultures are not getting less, I think it's a very good approach to try and, see if there could be a place of meeting. And this is some of the work we did, the study of it, and the model was a milled aluminium model. And it actually then consists of different type of functions just clustered together. And it was a very intense and difficult planning period because you were supposed to have a fully scaled museum next to an exhibition hall, next to an administration part and a national library and a cinema all together. So we worked very hard for this for at least 4 years in the planning process, and now it's a building site. And the client initially wanted to be clad in stone, which we were not that very keen on. So we tried different ways of finding how do you wrap around these shapes. And it ended up being quite simple. We just studied how to tread around this shape. And that became the concept for the facade. Here you see some model works and studies of how you could then, based on a steel tube, squashed this tube, and it became a louver in front of the few opening windows we should have. And this is the center of the core of the project, which is the source, which the museum is kind of a spiraling around. And then you see the keystone above with a big window, which will be like a debate and kind of conversation space, I think, which it ended up being. And this is the library. And we basically divided the project in three kind of zones. The lower part and everything from the museum and from the entrance level and down was the past. The entrance level was the present, and everything above that was the future. So based on this very simple scheme, we could identify and select the material that would fit in within that time zone. Here you see the cluster. And this is the building site at the moment. They are now more or less finishing with the climate walls. And we worked a lot with a German company called Seele about trying to find a way to do the facades, which was quite tricky. Here you see one of the workers. At the moment, there are 2,500 workers on the site. And I think we've been quite thorough of having working conditions that are not similar to what's going on in Qatar. So it's a good process on the working site at the moment. This is some of the details of the facade. It was actually, Seele has this type of facility where they can bend each tube based on a digital model and then put it together with a very high precision. And this is the building site at the moment. And I will show you now a small animation from the competition entry. For us, this was a very special project. I don't think we will ever get the chance to do anything like it again. And it's kind of also an end of an era for that type of maybe architecture and design as well. But I think for us, the experience working together with the client on that high level, evolving and programming and the culture center was very, very great learning curve for us, and hopefully I will be able to go down and see it after it's opened. I will end up with showing a few slides from a new opera house that we won a competition about in 2 years ago. It's in Busan in South Korea. It has similarities with the Oslo Opera, but still it's also quite different. This is the design for the competition. It's on the site. It's on kind of a peninsula in Busan in South Korea, which is a harbor city. And this is, you see the site and the building here, which is basically more or less a rectangular shaped building with a connecting area from the entrance level up to the roof. And this is just a simple scheme. It's kind of trying to work with two planes. One plane is bridging the site, the other one is embracing the sky, and then you have this hole that connects the two levels. And in between there, you have the functions for the opera house itself. Here you see some of the concept ideas behind it. And we also tried here, we work a lot with models and develop models over and over again, both with a 3D printer, and then we, you know, adjust it and do it over again. So we work with series of things to try and investigate it. And based on that, we also look into different type of way of connecting the two planes. And this is an illustration from the foyer. And you see the cityscape in the background. This is also the foyer with the, again, a wooden but slightly different structure for the main hall. And this is the great auditorium space. So I'll just finish up with showing us my last animation. This is now, we are starting the detail design of this at the moment, and I think it will open, I don't know, in 4 years or so.
And you don't answer when I call.
Yeah, so this was just a few samples of the things we've been working on for the last probably 25 years or so. But it's not so much about the design, it's more about the attitude and the way you approach the work and the project and the dialogue and within the working group, but also towards the client and the uniqueness of every kind of commission or project you do, because we think that it's important to try to tell a story that is interesting every time. So thank you.